There are also things that we can do during any pandemic that will help us all stay healthy. One is to minimize the time in the waiting rooms and encourage spacing emergency patients 6 feet apart if waiting is necessary. Again, keeping in mind that this is for treating emergency patients and patients with urgent needs only. Consider having patients wait in their car to be called in by phone or text message when a dental chair is available. If you need to see more than one patient at a time, you can exercise social distancing in the treatment areas by either putting patients in individual rooms or in larger facilities where there may be cubicles for dental treatment areas, distancing those patients at least 6 feet apart. And when you're providing services in an integrated health system with medical services, you should consult with your medical colleagues to review your protocols and also make adjustments that may be needed to the above steps. Some of these integrated healthcare systems may have stricter recommendations because they're under certain accrediting or certification bodies. And we need to get back to the basics and remind ourselves of what are the types of infection control precautions that we take with every patient, and take these while you're providing urgent care to your patients. And that is the standard use of PPE. Selecting the type and the amount of PPE is still based on the same concepts. If you're doing procedures that may produce a spray or a spatter of oral fluids, you should wear eye protection, a mask, a gown, and gloves. And those should be changed according to existing guidelines. Sterilization of critical and semi-critical instruments should continue, as well as surface disinfection. And the EPA has helped by posting a list of disinfectants that are effective against coronavirus on their website. You'll need your EPA number that's on the manufacturer's label for your product in order to see whether or not what you're using has been shown to be effective against coronavirus. Continue handling sharps safely and disposing of sharps appropriately. And now is a really good time to reinforce training. It's never a bad time to remind people of what our infection control precautions are and why we do them. And this training is really critical to us now. It's also important to know the difference between a surgical mask and a respirator, because we've seen so many of these come up now. In dentistry, we're not accustomed to using respirators on a regular basis and may not truly be prepared to do so. A surgical mask protects the mucous membranes of the wearer from contact with the patient body fluids. It can also be worn by a patient with a respiratory illness if they're coughing or sneezing to reduce the number of droplets that are released into the air when they're in contact with other people. A medical N95 respirator filters particles to prevent them from reaching the respiratory tract of the wearer. Different types of N95 respirators are available. There are some that are labeled as medical use, and usually those would be the only ones that would be appropriate in providing care to patients under certain circumstances. But because of this shortage, OSHA, the CDC, and the FDA have agreed that healthcare workers treating active COVID-19 patients may use N95 respirators that are not labeled for medical use. However, they still need to comply with the other requirements for preparing one to use a respirator. And those requirements include a written respiratory protection program, and that employers institute engineering and work practice controls before resorting to PPE as a measure to protect workers. And that's always the case. If we can remove or isolate the hazard rather than using protective equipment, that is always preferable. Before an employee can use an N95 respirator, they must have a medical exam by a qualified healthcare provider. That healthcare provider will have them complete a questionnaire, and based on the answers to that questionnaire, they may or may not need a physical medical exam. They also need to have annual fit testing of the respirator that they will be using and receive specific training, including training on COVID-19. OSHA has modified some of the requirements and could still modify them further. So before undertaking the use of N95 respirators, you should look to the OSHA website to see what changes may have occurred. There's a lot of terminology that's kind of new to us, and making sure that we understand what it means is important. Social distancing is a way to mitigate the spread of disease by keeping people apart from one another. And the CDC website provides a lot of guidance on how we can mitigate the transfer of diseases in the community settings and also in the healthcare settings. Now, exactly what social distancing is in terms of what our local health departments are asking us to do can vary depending on a lot of factors. And the CDC does provide those health agencies with guidance on how to decide which measures are appropriate for that local community. And these are all currently being decided on local, by that I mean city and county level, and on state level. I think we all know that yesterday the governor of California issued a statewide shelter in place, and the governor of New York did the same today. Implementing mitigation strategies in communities with low levels of transmission may still be effective in reducing overall infection rates. And that's why the White House is asking all people in the United States to take these measures. We have school closures, even in areas where there may not be any cases in that city. We need to limit our social activities and gatherings, including events and faith-based services. Reconsider any non-essential travel, and increasingly, it's becoming more and more difficult to travel by air, even if we wanted to. Develop work from home, and if you can, relax sick leave policies. So if we do have a need to go to work to treat urgent care patients, that people who are ill know that they can stay home. We also hear the term shelter in place. And shelter in place is generally an increased effort to distance people from each other to slow the spread of infections. And that would include closure of non-essential businesses, such as retail outlets, orders to remain at home with your household contacts only, and only leave your house for essential needs such as groceries and prescriptions. And increasingly, we're seeing this level of precaution being implemented, especially in areas where we know we have higher ongoing community transmissions. Limiting businesses that must stay open to essential functions, essential personnel, and they also may impose restrictions on hours that these can remain open. And all of this is done as part of that effort that we talked about earlier, which is flattening the curve. I think that's going to be the saying of 2020. So now I think we really understand why we're reducing the practice to urgent care only. It's going to help us limit contact with potentially infected individuals, conserve those supplies of PPE for the most critical medical care. And we also need to avoid becoming infected and spreading the infection to household contacts and others. So there are guidances on what type of PPE and precautions that you can use in your practice when you're providing urgent care to patients. And on March 16th, again, the American Dental Association recommended that all U.S. dental practice limit treatment to emergency or urgent procedures. And we've also seen notices come out from state and local dental associations. We've seen state boards of licensure require that people close their practices to non-urgent care. And the CDC and the White House have made these recommendations as well. We talked about telemedicine, which we don't have a lot of in dentistry, but something that you can do is instead of having patients come in to be triaged for emergency care, provide that triage over the phone. And maybe you can determine whether or not an in-person visit is really necessary, or can they be assisted through pharmacological means or other types of advice or home care. If you have a patient that must be treated, ask the screening questions for COVID-19 risk so you can take the appropriate precautions. And if the person does not have COVID-19 or are not at risk, provide standard precautions. And if somebody is ill and you need to treat them, then use droplet precautions, which we'll talk about next. So droplet precautions are in addition to standard precautions. And these precautions are used when treating patients that are known or suspected to be infected with pathogens that are transmitted by the respiratory droplets that are generated when a patient coughs, sneezes, or talks and is infected with one of these pathogens. The recommendation for that is while the patient is waiting, have them wear a mask. And again, that reduces the spread to other people and the environment. Place the patient in a single room, and then put a mask on yourself before you go into the patient room and leave it on until you leave, which is different than standard precautions, which would be that you would remove the mask immediately after treatment In this case, you want to leave it on until you're outside of the room. You can remove your gloves before you leave the room. Wear a respirator if you're treating patients diagnosed or being investigated for COVID-19, but if you don't have a respirator, if the supplies are limited, you can prioritize N95 respirators for procedures that generate aerosols, respiratory aerosols, and wear a surgical mask for other procedures. You can also consider the use of a face shield in addition to a mask to reduce the potential for the mask becoming wet. There are other things that we can do too. We can try to prepare for when normal operations resume, because they will. You can clean and stock your clinics. You can follow any screening protocols that are recommended by health authorities for accepting patients and returning to work, because when we come back, there may be things that we need to do before we can resume all of our normal operations, and we'll need the help of our health authorities and experts to guide us in what those steps might be. If you currently have excess stock of PPE that's critically needed for frontline healthcare workers, consider contacting your local hospital to see if you can share that excess stock. And continue to monitor reliable sources of information such as the CDC, ADA, and OSAP.